So we are on our fifth and final day, and two topics remain. We have decided to de-emphasize cycles, so we will spend major amount of time on combined first and second laws. Traditionally, the name of this topic is availability analysis. Or exergy analysis. The difference is historical. Sometimes availability analysis was pertaining to the closed thermodynamic systems. Exergy analysis pertained to open thermodynamic systems. It's also possible that exergy was a word coined by East Europeans and Russian engineers. Availability was used by Western Europe and Western workers. But the fact remains that there is absolutely no new basic principle of thermodynamics involved. We use first law and second law together. So that is why it's a combined analysis. And that is the reason why I have kept the topic as combined first and second law. If somebody quickly goes through the topics, they'll say, where is availability? Where is exergy? Exergy is nothing but combined first and second law. So what is this analysis? This analysis helps us do the following. We have a vague idea that SP or S dot P, which is always positive or at most equal to 0, is not a good thing. That's the basic idea. We should reduce SP or S dot P. Why? Maybe it is better that way. I'll put a question mark. Why is it better? We don't know, but that's our mental set. And that is based on the, again, a mental set that a reversible process would be an ideal process. That means it would be best possible. And the reason for that is simple. One of the aspects of life which tells us that nothing is reversible is the progress of time. And it is the second law which tells us that in any thermodynamic system's behavior, there will always be a state before and a state after, whatever happens. If you have a situation in which everything is reversible, remember that when a system executes a reversible process, or a pair of systems interacting with each other execute a reversible process. In principle, it is possible for us to reverse everything and bring the systems back to the original state without any other thing changing. So if a system has executed a reversible process and then reversed it back, and if we were not observing that a process was taking place, we would never know ever that a process has taken place. If in a particular zone, say in this room, everything were to take place reversibly, then that means our clocks would have to stop because there is no before, there is no after. Okay? There is no before, there is no after. So time would lose its meaning and everything would become you know, amar in our, as we say, undying, and perhaps that's the idea right from our philosophers. So amruta was always an attractive thing, the elixir of life. That gave us an idea that something which extends life, something which takes meaning away from time would be important. In thermodynamics, that attracts us to the ideal of a reversible set of processes. We have used it for defining entropy and doing many other good things. But that has given us a mental behavior, mental set, that a reversible process is ideal. Since an irreversible process produces entropy, entropy production is bad. And that has given us, led us to the quest, which has led to exergy analysis. As for every process, let us calculate SP or S dot P. We know how to do it from our second law analysis. But by combining the first and second law, we are able to provide some physical meaning to the value of SP. And then we can make efforts to see how it can be reduced. And when you reduce it, what happens, or what do you have to do to reduce it? So our thing is presence of SP or S dot P would lead to loss of work. That means you could have obtained a work, say maximum amount of work. You obtained only the actual amount of work W. So this would be the lost work. What is the maximum amount of work? That we have yet to determine. Or it could lead to, you can look at the other way, waste of heat. We know heat has to be supplied to do some work, to do some job, to provide a change of state, to accomplish a task. Maybe thermodynamics will give us the minimum amount of heat which is required to do the task. But if we consume something more than that, this is the amount of waste of heat. You could have done with this, but you are unnecessarily using something more. So the combined first and second laws together, or the exergy analysis, would give us an idea of either the loss of work or lost work or the waste of heat or wasted heat. Usually, people look at it essentially from the lost work point of view, but we can always turn it around and look at it from a wastage of heat point of view. How do we do this? We do the following. We use first and second laws for the actual process. Then we think of an ideal process. And naturally, for an ideal process, our idea is an ideal process must be reversible. And that means for such a process, SP should be 0, or S dot P should be 0, whatever way you are looking at it. Then we define, using the difference between the two, typically lost work. And link this up to SP or S dot. And while doing this, we often come across the components of the process. Which contribute to lost work. I will take a diversion. We will go to our exercises. And we go back to the last exercise in second law, 4.10. I skipped it at that time because although it uses first law and second law, I think it is appropriate to do it at this time because it's related to what we are going to do now. But just to emphasize that nothing more than first or second law is to be used, we will do it now. So exercise 4.10. We have a closed system. It undergoes a process between fixed initial and final states, say 1 and 2, such that the overall changes in energy, entropy and volume are delta E, delta S and delta V respectively. That means you have a closed system which executes a process such that change in energy is delta E, change in volume is delta V, change in entropy is delta S. The only input of energy to the system is from condensing steam at a temperature TS. So there is a temperature TS. Let us say the heat absorbed is given, amount of heat absorbed from steam by the system is Q. From the steam by the system, so our direction is all right. The only outputs of energy are the heat transfer to the environment. It is given that T naught is the temperature of the environment. So let us say the interaction with the environment, which is at T naught, is Q naught. And work done in displacing the environment. So because of this delta V, the environment gets displaced and that is P naught. So that means the work done is the expansion work. And since it is only against the environment, it would be P naught delta V. Apply the first law to the system, apply the second law to the system, and show that the irreversibility in the process gives rise to a wastage of thermal energy, that means wastage of heat of steam by an amount as given. So let's do. How do you apply first law to the system? First law to the system simply means Q equals delta E plus W. Okay? But there are two components of Q here. So the first law would simply say Q plus Q naught is delta E plus W. W is P naught delta V. If you really want to be particular, call this Q S. Write the first law as Q equals delta E plus W, then write Q as Q S plus Q naught and W as P naught delta. Okay, I am taking a bit of a shot here. Second law. What does the second law says? Delta S must be greater than or equal to sigma or integral Q by T plus SP. Let's put it the turn it around. We'll put delta S on one side, but on this side, Q by delta Q by T has two components: Q by T S plus Q naught by T naught. This has to be change in entropy of the system, delta S plus any entropy produced. Actually, this is not second law. This is a relation linking SP to all this. Second law actually says SP must be greater than or equal to 0. This is definition of SP. This part is definition of SP. This part is, this is the real second law. So let me call this equation 1. Let me call this equation 2. It is minus SP. I made a mistake. So let me correct it and say this has to be plus SP here equal to delta S. Okay. multiply 2 by T naught. What do you get? You will get Q into T naught by Ts plus Q naught plus T naught Sp equals, what is on the other side, T naught delta S. This is 2A, or you can call it 3. We had the first equation, Q plus Q naught is delta E plus P naught delta V. Q plus Q naught is delta E plus P naught delta V. 1. You can eliminate Q naught between the two, and you will get, for example, you subtract 2A from 1. So you will get Q into 1 minus T naught by Ts minus T naught Sp equals delta E plus P naught delta V minus T naught delta S. Solve this for Q. Q equals, okay, I will put everything on one side. I will have delta E plus P naught delta V minus T naught delta S plus T naught Sp. This is Ts minus T naught by Ts. So this will be Ts by Ts minus. Am I right? Now notice that Sp will have values which are 0 or positive. Thermodynamically, the ideal value is 0. And notice that as I reduce Sp, I will come to a minimum value of Q. I am assuming here that Ts is greater than T naught. And that is a inherent assumption here. So that gives us Q min, which is obtained by putting Sp equals 0. This would lead to Q min, which is delta E plus P naught delta V minus T naught delta S into Ts and Q by Q min is Q wasted. That is what the answer we have, Q minus Q min, the value of Q min is as given. All that we have done is we have used first law, we have used second law, and notice here that the interaction with the environment Q naught that we eliminated, and we said that using the link between Q and Sp, we determined Q min, which is at Sp equal to 0. So anything which is Q minus Q min would be Q wasted. Now the question that arises, this is what thermodynamics and even the exergy analysis doesn't directly tell us. What shall I do to reach this state of Q min? Notice that the first law should also be valid. So if you want Q to be reduced to Q min, see, on the right hand side, delta E and P naught delta V, it's something you can't change. Change in the state of the system, pressure of the environment, invariant. You want a particular change in the state of the system. So you must execute in such a process in such a way that the, if you want to minimize Q, you must manipulate Q naught. Change Q such that Q goes to Q minimum and Q naught goes to the appropriate value, which still keeps the balance. How to do that, thermodynamics doesn't tell. That's for other engineering ideas to be implemented. Okay. Now, although this was in the second law section, this exactly is what we do in exergy analysis. And although textbooks tend to indicate that exergy analysis is some standard analysis, exergy analysis is not a standard analysis. Okay. However, to define properties or pseudo properties called availability and exergy, the general idea which is used is essentially this, but then we have it straitjacketed. So suppose we have a system and we have the interactions, heat absorbed, work done, and let us say the system during the process goes from state 1 to state 2. What does the first law tell us? First law tells us simply delta E is Q minus W. This is first law. The second law tells us that delta E is either integral summation whatever of Q by T plus SP with SP greater than or equal to 0. Now aim, reduce SP to 0. Now notice that if you want to reduce SP to 0, this equation has to be satisfied, and as you change SP, either you will have to change Q or you will have to change delta S. That means either you must give up some or modify some interaction or say that the system should go to a different state because I want a reversible process. You can't say that I must have this interaction, the system must go to that space, in which case you can't change SP. So if you want to improve situation, quote unquote improve, by reducing SP, you must allow yourself to change either the end state or the interaction or both. If you don't allow a change in the state but allow a change in the interaction, so then naturally Q will change, here Q will change, and then your W will automatically change. Usually, a reduction in SP would mean, because delta S is the same, a reduction in SP generally means an increase in Q. And an increase in Q here generally means an increase in W algebraically. Okay? So generally, a reduction in SP, if end states are kept the same, improves the work interaction, that means the work extracted, and hence the idea of a maximum work has come about. But remember, to reduce SP to 0, we must either change interactions or change end state, or both. The standard availability or exergy analysis, which we will now derive, allows us not to change end states but change interactions to such an extent that even an adiabatic process would be replaced by a non-adiabatic process. Because if you say that your original process is adiabatic, that means Q is 0. And if you say you don't want to change end states, that means delta E and delta S state you don't want to change. But if you want to reduce SP, then naturally Q has to be changed from 0 to non-zero. So even to that extent, one has to consider in our standard availability or exergy analysis. So we will now look at what is known as the classical analysis of availability / exergy. Since availability and exergy are used interchangeably, we will say that availability generally pertains to closed systems. Exergy analysis usually pertains to open systems. And in this classical analysis, what we have is the following. We have the idea of an environment. Which usually means the surroundings and which is usually modeled as a large system or a reservoir, P naught, T naught unchanged. Then you say that any amount of Q naught with environment is possible. And this is the one interaction which we will be changing to go from the real situation to the ideal situation. Then third, we say there is the idea of useful work. Here the idea is useful work is defined as the actual work done by the system during a process minus P naught delta V. Why P naught delta V? Because if the volume of the system changes by delta V or increases by delta V, then the atmosphere is pushed back by that amount. So the process, during the process the system will have to do work P naught delta V against the atmosphere. That work will be absorbed by the atmosphere and is not useful to us for any other purpose. So that is this idea of useful work. And we do this by assuming that we have fixed initial and final states and fixed interactions except Q naught, which is the energy transfer with the environment, and W. Because we want to go from W to W maximum, so that we must allow, and the only change we allow is Q naught. And now we proceed with an analysis which is very similar to that in exercise 4.10. This is our system, goes from state 1 to state 2. Delta E, delta V, delta S. It does some work W, but W useful is W minus P naught delta. And let us say that the other interactions are, one interaction Q naught at T naught, and the other interaction it say at T1, so much parallax, Q at T or QI at TI, whatever you want to add. Apply first law. What do you get? Q plus Q naught equals delta E plus W, and W we will write as W useful plus P naught
delta. Okay. Second law. Q by T plus Q naught by T naught plus SP equals delta S. Equation 1, equation 2. Multiply 2 by T naught, standard trick. Q into T naught by T plus Q naught plus T naught SP equals T naught delta S. And eliminate Q naught, eliminate Q naught between 1 and 2A. Here we will subtract 2A from 1 and we will get Q into 1 minus T naught by T, Q naught gets eliminated, minus T naught SP equals delta E plus WU plus P naught delta V minus T naught delta S. Let me call this equation 3. Now transpose equation by putting WU on one side and everything else on the other side. WU becomes Q 1 minus T naught by T. Okay. That is one term. WU will have minus T naught SP on the other side, but what remains is the negative of delta E plus P naught delta V minus T naught delta S. Minus delta E plus P naught delta V minus T naught delta S minus T naught SP. Check that the algebra is right. Is that right? Okay. Now, what is this? What can be the value of SP? 0 or more than 0. In general, it will be positive. So in general, this T naught SP or minus T naught SP will be a negative number. If I reduce T naught SP, the value of the right hand side will improve. Right? When SP equals 0, the value of the right hand side is maximum, that is our WU max. So whatever is here, this equals WU max. And what is this? T naught SP is WU max minus WU, maximum possible work under the conditions that no change in end states. Only change possible is in change of interaction with the environment, heat interaction with environment. Okay. This is known as lost work, not with a negative sign, just this is lost work. So the W useful is W useful max minus lost work. Okay. All that is it does is tell us that SP has some significance. Multiply SP with the environment temperature, and that represents the amount of work which you could have obtained perhaps by executing the whole thing in a reversible way, but did not obtain or could not obtain. Okay. That is why it is known as lost work. Now, in this itself, there are two components. First component is this, the second component is this. This Q into 1 minus T naught by T. What is this? We have come across this earlier. 1 minus T naught by T is the efficiency of a reversible 2T heat engine working between T as the source and T naught as the sink. If Q is the heat absorbed by such an engine, this is the maximum possible work one can do. Okay. So this is WU max from Q at T. And this, now that we know this, textbooks on availability will say this is the availability or this is the exergy of that heat which is available to us at T. And then they will say that look, if T is higher, for a fixed T naught, higher the T, better is the availability of Q. And lower the T, poorer is the availability of Q. Because if T naught is 300 Kelvin, T is 600 Kelvin, only half of Q is available as work. Whereas if T is 1200 Kelvin, then 3/4 of Q will be available. And it so happens that however high be T, unless you go infinitely high, Q will never be completely available to us as work. And that is why the idea that Q is a low grade energy cannot directly be fully converted into work comes out of this. Nothing to do with availability analysis, something to do with our second law of thermodynamics. But this is known as the availability or exergy of Q. And then those textbooks will have cranky problems that demonstrate that the exergy of heat depends on the temperature at which it is available, which is shown by this expression. Now the second term, I will write it down as minus delta E plus P naught V minus P naught S. And this E plus P naught V plus T naught S, it is not a property. E plus PV minus TS will be a property because only properties of the system is involved. But E plus P naught V minus T naught S, I can call it, or people call it, a pseudo property because it depends on the property of the state but also depends on the environment. This is given the symbol phi so that this can be written down as minus delta phi or minus phi 2 minus phi 1. And what is this? This is WU max due to change of So, remember this is like a potential. Remember yesterday's calculations in property relations? During a constant temperature process, the maximum work that one can obtain is the reduction in the Helmholtz function. So, during an adiabatic process in which there is no Q, maximum useful work which can be obtained is the reduction in this property or pseudo property phi, perfectly analogous, okay. Or in a gravitational field, if a body changes the height, maximum work that can be obtained would be the reduction in the gravitational potential energy, perfectly analogous to that. So this means that phi is something like a potential, or why not similar, phi you can consider to be a potential. You can write, I am getting bored, reduction in which represents the maximum useful work that can be obtained due to change of state. And during that change of state, what interactions are admissible? The only interaction admissible apart from doing work is heat transfer with the environment. This Q is not admissible because that itself will add to some work. But that Q naught which you have eliminated is admissible. So this is a potential which represents the maximum useful work due to change of state when only Q naught 2 from T naught, 2 or from T naught is admissible. Okay. Now, is this idea clear? This is simply algebra. We have used first law, we have used second law, and we have decided that what happens if SP is reduced to 0, which gives us WU max. Apart from that, only definitions and nomenclatures are involved, nothing more, nothing less. And now, to confuse you, some more definitions and some more nomenclature. Phi is known as the availability of the system, or sometimes it is known as the availability function, or sometimes the even exergy of the system, because availability and exergy are used interchangeably. But there is a modification. We notice that WU max, I will say Q naught only, would be minus phi 2 minus phi 1. So only differences in phi are of significance, just the way differences in energy only are significant and only differences in entropy are significant. But the modification to this in the definition of phi, not to this, is often you consider this. What is P naught, T naught? What have we defined it to be? Pressure and temperature of the surroundings. Then if we say that, look, I have a system and I will leave it free to do whatever it feels like with the surroundings. So I have a balloon with warm air or cold air in it and I leave it to do whatever it feels like with the surroundings. Feel it to exchange energy with the surroundings. Finally, what will happen to its temperature? It will come to T naught. I say that, look, I remove all stresses, make it freely expandable balloon, allow it to expand to its heart's content. What will be the pressure that it will reach? P naught. Okay. So P naught, T naught, which is the pressure and temperature of the environment, also equals the so-called state which the system may eventually reach. If left free to interact with the environment. This is also known as a dead state for some reason, nothing to do with death, but it is known as a dead state. So you leave a system sufficiently long to interact with the environment and don't put any other constraints. Don't put it in a pressurized cylinder. Let there be a piston which is free to expand till pressure equalizes. What do we get? Finally, the system comes to a dead state. Quite often, phi is defined not as E plus P naught V minus T naught S, but it is defined as this minus E naught plus P naught V naught minus T naught, S naught, where E naught, V naught and S naught are the properties of the system when it reaches the state P naught, T naught. So this definition sort of eliminates the question, what is the availability of steam at 100 bar 400 degrees C. Now you will ask, with respect to what? One can say with respect to whatever is the reference of the energy, whatever is the reference for entropy. In principle, these two references could be different. But if we define it like this, then with respect to the corresponding dead state, some books and some authors tend to follow this definition. This is an alternative definition in which this is an additional constant term and which sort of gives us a reference. This remains the same because phi 2 minus phi naught, nothing, no analysis changes, only the reference for phi changes. Now I think before I go to the exergy analysis for open systems, it is proper to do some problems, and that brings us to exercise sheet combined first and second laws, which is exercise sheet 7. But in the assignment to you, I have called it CL. So when you submit it, instead of 7.1, 7.2, let's call it CL1, CL2. That way the topic numbers and these numbers are. Now notice, assume that the environment is at P0 1 bar, T0 300K, unless specified otherwise. That is the default environment parameters. 7.1 is of interest because this gives us an idea that we means vacuum means nothing, shunya in our philosophy, but can we extract some work out of vacuum? The question is, vacuum in the absolute interstellar space, we may not be extract work out of because it exists naturally. But in the earthly environment where the surroundings is at one atmosphere, we need to spend power and effort and money to create a vacuum. So naturally vacuum is useful, and there must be some work extractable from a perfectly evacuated space of volume V vac. So first let's look at it this way. This is our system. It has a volume V vac. It has no temperature associated with it. Its pressure is zero. There is no mass in it. Okay. So first absolute formula use by keeping our brain power away for some time. What is the maximum useful work? This will be minus phi 2 minus phi 1, right? Okay. What is phi 2? E naught plus P naught, V naught plus T naught, S naught. Now forget P naught, V naught. There is no mass, so there is no E, there is no S, but what about vacuum in the final state? This is 2, final. See, this is going to be E2 plus T0 V2 minus T0 S2. That is the first part. The second part is going to be E1 plus P0 V1 minus T0 S1. Okay. First, let us look at this part. What does it contain? Nothing. Does it have any energy? No. So E1 is 0, initial state. Okay. So initial state, this is state 1. We will then sketch the state 2 when we really realize. Is there any entropy associated with it? Nothing. There is no mass, nothing, no entropy. So this term also goes. P naught atmospheric pressure. What is the initial volume? V1 is VVAC. So V1 is VVAC. So this particular term becomes P naught into VVAC. Okay. What about here? This is the state 2, which is equilibrium with environment. What do you do when you bring it in equilibrium with environment? Does the vacuum remain? Nothing. So nothing remains. The system simply vanishes. If it were a balloon, because it is vacuum, it will just go to zero volume. And anyway, it doesn't contain any mass. So E2 would be zero as earlier, S2 would be zero as earlier, even V2 would be zero as earlier. So what remains is simply P naught V1 with a negative sign with another negative sign, and that is P naught V back. This is the maximum useful work according to our formula, the way we understand it. So, two equilibrium with environment essentially means the system contains nothing, doesn't even have a volume. Right? Is this right? Can we think of an experiment where we can demonstrate that this can be done? Let's look at it this way. Let us say that I have the vacuum of VVAC and I have created it in a cylinder piston arrangement, and I have, because the pressure here is P naught, the area is A, and let us say the, so VVAC is product of L and A. I must hold the piston against this pressure, otherwise piston will simply move into the vacuum. Principle used in vacuum brakes. So all I do is I apply a force here by putting it on a frictionless, inertialess pulley, inextensible, unbreakable string, and put an appropriate mass here so that my mass is such that mg equals P naught A. Forces balanced. Now all I do to bring this in equilibrium with the environment is simply tap that piston slightly, tap, tap. What will happen? I have provided a small impulse. So slowly the piston will move. There is no force difference across the piston, but that small impulse which I have provided allows it to move very slowly, steadily into the vacuum. When will it stop? It will stop when it reaches the dead end at the other. Of course, if it's an elastic collision, it will bounce back, but I'll see to it that I tap it again. So stay there. What has happened? Piston has moved in by a distance L. What has happened to the mass? Mass has moved up by an elevation L. Basic definition of thermodynamic work. How much work is done? P naught A into L, which is P naught into VVAC. Okay. So W, because it is useful, I have used it for raising the weight, is M into G into L, which is P naught into A into L, which is P naught into V back. Understood? This is basic thermodynamics. On the previous page, what we had done is a dumb application of the availability and exergy analysis. And mind you, something like this you can always do. This is a very simple situation. So it was very obvious what to do. But in a more complicated situation also you can do, because all that you are doing is applying first law, applying second law, and considering the option by changing SP by changing an appropriate interaction. And mind you, the standard exergy analysis does not allow you to change end states. It allows you to change only the interaction with the environment. And that sometimes leads to a problem, because sometimes we want the process to be adiabatic. Adiabatic means no interaction of heat with anything. So how do you apply the availability analysis? The standard availability analysis cannot be used, because the standard availability analysis says that to go from WU to WU max, change the interaction with the environment. But that means if initially it was 0, now you have to make it non-zero. And you will say that, look, I need an adiabatic process for some reason. Why do you force me to have a heat transfer? You know, that is why availability and exergy analysis only talks about the thermodynamic ideal. It does not take into account the ground reality what we have. This will become clear when we look at, you can calculate the lost work, but how are you going to extract it? Okay. That's precisely the problem that comes up. Nothing, in my absolutely personal opinion, this is so that some people can write books or chapters in books, and I can spend time about 2-3 hours explaining to you what all this thing is about. Otherwise, apart from first law and second law, there is absolutely nothing new except certain ideas and certain nomenclature and definitions.
So guys, in a paper that Rivera had a comment when minor analysis of an imagination. She had written a comment that there is no exergy analysis for the thing.
Your answer should be, what I have done is exergy analysis without saying so. If we do this, will you call it exergy analysis? If you do this, what will you call it? You will call it basic thermodynamics. But that's what it is. It is basic thermodynamics.
I met a person from Delhi College of Engineering, a professor. He said, I am expert in this, I want your paper, so I will
ask him to register as a student in the June workshop. That's what anybody, you know, who comes and meets you saying, oh, I know everything about it. Oh, then why don't you attend the June workshop? That should be.
So even frequently some people in some research try to
it is, it is dangerous to mix two disciplines unless you have a person who is equally comfortable in both the disciplines, or one expert in one discipline, another expert in another discipline, who are equally comfortable with each other. Okay. And that, you know, either a pair or a set of people, maybe a few economists and a few engineers equally comfortable with each other, or a few people who are equally comfortable in both economics and engineering. That's a very, very rare combination.
I think Bejan's book.
Yes, Bejan's books is perhaps the only place where there is a balanced thing. But he doesn't talk much about economics. He remains within the thermodynamic domain. Actually, one of the characteristics of Bejan's books is that he does not make any non-thermodynamic comments. It's an excellent book, but you can notice that he is restraining himself by not making certain comments.
Is there any difference in available energy and availability?
Availability is nothing but a short form for available energy. Similarly, exergy is a short form for excluded energy. That's how this nomenclature has come. Available energy means available for what? Available for converting into useful work. That's it. So that is what we have said here. We have said that this is availability or exergy of Q, which is available at T. That's what he is saying.
Okay.